Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Sri Lanka has been witnessing some dramatic developments in its power structures. The President Sirisena has sacked the Prime Minister Wickremesinghe and appointed in his place the former President Rajapaksa instead. And the country has been in a state of turmoil and confusion since then, and the parliament has also been suspended. So we have with us today Professor Sasanka Perera, who is the Vice President of South Asian University and an expert on Sri Lankan affairs, to talk about these developments. Welcome, Mr. Perera. So, we know that Sirisena and Wickremesinghe had been at odds with each other since the beginning of their term in 2015. They had their differences in the past as well. But what is the immediate provocation for this sacking on Friday? What were the developments in the past few weeks which led to this?
I think the immediate provocation was probably Mr. Wickremesinghe's visit to India, and in which he met the Indian Prime Minister and issued a statement soon after, more or less blaming the President for the non-happening of Indian-funded projects in Sri Lanka, which is a fact. But then, it is not also smart politics. You don't come to a neighboring country, meet its prime minister, and then issue a statement critiquing your own president. Simply bad politics. But to me, this is something that was bound to happen. Because in the case of these two individuals, ideology is not the only problem, it is simply one of the many. It is also a matter of class. It is also a matter of ways in which you look at the world. And these people are polar opposites. So this is why when the president spoke to the nation on Sunday, he actually said that he gave a whole list of things that Mr. Wickremesinghe is supposed to have done. And one of them is that his lack of collegiality with the president, plus the fact that he does not really understand the pulse of the people. You know, that kind of, it's a kind of a class critique in that sense. But see, the point to you can look at it in a number of ways. One is to see whether it's legal or constitutional, and the second is to see whether it's ethical or moral, right? Now, constitutionally, these two people, when they came to power in 2015, one of the things they did was to add an amendment to the constitution, the 19th amendment, and it was supposed to curtail the power of the executive presidency, president, to arbitrarily remove the prime minister, which has been done before. And so under those circumstances, the prime minister can only be removed if he resigns, if he dies, or if he ceases to be a member of parliament. Alternatively, if his government loses the budget, or if he loses a no confidence motion, then that too would mark the end of the prime minister. But none of these things happened. So to me, the more legitimate way to do this would have been, on the 5th of November, the budget was supposed to be presented. That would have been the date on which to challenge this the Prime Minister and see whether he had the numbers. If he didn't have it, he would have lost, and whoever who had the numbers could have been appointed the Prime Minister. That would have been the more legitimate way of doing it.
But we know that Wickremesinghe is saying that he does have the numbers, which is why he wanted to call the Parliament in session, have an emergency vote. But the Parliament was suspended.
It was. It has been suspended until the 16th, and I think that is why what makes it immoral. Because you make this decision without the former or whatever. I think Sri Lanka now has two prime ministers, effectively. One who has been legitimately elected, and the other nobody really knows the status of. It has two cabinets, effectively. So it is this is the kind of situation this country has not been in before. So nobody really knows. But to me, the more dangerous thing is this, that in the streets, there isn't much concern.
Okay.
And to me, that is far more dangerous than anything else. And that, to me, the way I look at it is there is too much fatigue. And generally what people will say at least the people I've spoken to, what difference does it make? You have one crook, he leaves and another crook comes over, what's the difference? It doesn't touch us, you know, that kind of attitude.
But the Rajapaksa has had, I mean, during his tenure, of course, the war ended, the civil war ended, and there were a lot of human rights violations. So he had a lot of opposition from Tamilians. So what would his return mean? Are these Tamilians not opposing him?
No, they see, not only Tamilians, even in the Sinhala polity, quite a few people do oppose him too. I mean, he lost the election after all, the last election. But this is also a moral problem. No, because of those human rights issues, because of massive corruption and so on and so forth, which the president has been critiquing until maybe a week ago. I mean, to hand over the prime ministership to such a person when all those things remained unresolved is unfathomable, right? So obviously, an average regular Tamil citizen will not find this very comforting. Not only that, a regular citizen of any ethnicity who's interested in things like freedom of expression and so on and so forth will also be uncomfortable. But he does have a lot of support too.
So you talked about, you said this was in a way inevitable, you expected this to happen because they've had differences. So can you tell us more about the sort of differences between Wickremesinghe and Sirisena?
See, I think one of the biggest problems was that Wickremesinghe was more keen to hand over parts of the country's economic assets to foreign entities, including China and India. These are the two main contenders. But also privatization of state-owned property in general, within the country as well. Sirisena has generally been not particularly fond of this. But then you also have to ask the question, where did this whole thing begin? The present wave of privatization and selling of public assets has actually started in the time of Mr. Rajapaksa, in the sense that the kinds of programs he started, like this harbor in the south, airport also in the south, which now I hear has been taken over by some Indian company. These kinds of things were so expensive that the money really could not, the loans could not really be paid. So then it means that a number of other things have to be, divested. So that, this was the Prime Minister's approach. So the other is, I think, Mr. Sirisena's, the President's power base was really not that strong, right? So how do you create some kind of power base for yourself? And I think nationalism, like all of our leaders do in this part of the world, was, I think that was his choice, because this is why Rajapaksa himself was very powerful, because he did play his nationalist and Buddhist card fairly strongly. So, in a sense, I think Sirisena was trying to play that too, whereas Ranil Wickremesinghe's track record was such that he really could not play that kind of card.
They also made certain promises when they came into power, when they formed this coalition, that of course the main reason was to get Rajapaksa out because there was so much opposition against him. But there were also a lot of big promises they made, that they will reduce the president's power, the power will be more decentralized, and Tamilians will get more relief. So what do you feel about these promises? How have they fared on these?
See, 19th Amendment, which has slightly reduced the power of the president to sack the prime minister, was the first step in that direction of abolishing the executive presidency. That was the promise. But once in power, it was very clear that the president was not particularly keen to go in that direction, right? That is one. Second, in the case of promises given to the Tamil population. The main promise was to hand over the land that was taken over from them for military purposes, and also to release political prisoners. So, in by and large, most political prisoners, I think, have been released, right? And quite a bit of land has also been handed over from the military to the original owners. But still, when it comes to the land around the northern airport in Palali, that much of it still remains under the control of the military. So I doubt whether there will be complete return to the situation prior to war when it comes to these kinds of issues. The other promise was, the other major promise that both of these individuals gave the polity in their campaign was about ending corruption. Now that obviously hasn't happened either, because many of the people who were accused, including Mr. Rajapaksa, no serious investigation has ever taken place. And certainly no serious cases of punishment have also been meted out to anybody. So it is in this sense that this present scenario becomes far more problematic, because here is a situation where people, the two individuals, led a campaign against corruption and ending political violence and so on and so forth. And at one point, they break up, and the main culprit, which both of them have pointed their finger at, is given a very important job, that of the Prime Minister. So that, to me, the lack of morality and ethics is the main problem. I mean, I will leave the decision on whether the this appointment is legal or not to the Supreme Court, if it ever goes to the Supreme Court or to constitutional experts. To me, the problem is that it's so bad because of the longer term negative impacts on Sri Lanka's already fragile democracy.
And you do feel this was just a way to secure Rajapaksa's voter base or support base?
Not only that, I think Rajapaksa looks at it slightly differently. Voter base, I don't think, really eroded that much, right? I mean, he did get quite a bit of votes in the last election too. He did have that base didn't really change that much. The main thing for him by coming back to power is to ensure that the kinds of allegations that have been brought against him, his family and his colleagues will probably never be investigated. So that, it's about self-preservation too. And in the case of Sirisena, it is obviously about survival. And he obviously has an interest also to be reappointed to be elected as president again, even though he has been saying that this is his first and last attempt. But whether that happens or not remains to be seen.
Okay. So, thank you. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Perera, for joining us today.
Oh.
Thank you for watching this click.